You got it. Good morning. Welcome to St. Bart's. Please stand. We will pray and we will begin our worship together. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the slightest hint and promise of fall in front of us for the beginning of school and new starts. And we pray, Lord, that as we gather in your name, you would be in our midst and that you would bless us as we sing your praises, as we hear from your word, and as we meet you at your table. Bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. Remain standing for opening hymn.
Beloved hymn together, all creatures.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice to Him and sing. Alleluia, alleluia. The burning sun with golden beam, the silver moon with softer gleam.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Together, let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Could ever breathe.
Cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you.
death is just a doorway to resurrection life. If I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing and my song will be the same.
King of heaven, my treasure.
Lord God, we, in the quiet, acknowledge that you are our treasure, that you are the great treasure buried in the field, and that with joy you ask us to sell everything we have to attain that treasure. So help us to see you as you are. Help us to see you for the great and worthy King that you are, that we might joyfully lay down our lives, be living sacrifices, be all those things that by your Spirit, Lord, you empower us to be, that you call us to be. We want to be your people. We want to bear witness to the world, Lord, of your goodness, of your truth, of your mercy, and most of all, Lord, of your love. Help us to be that people. Help St. Bart's to be that kind of church that bears witness to your love and that manifests your love in the world in the power of your Spirit. And Lord, we acknowledge in our own frailty and just in the day-to-day that we forget that we lose sight of that, and we ask you to forgive us. As we move into a time of confession, please sit or kneel. Together, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The Lord be with you. Keep your church, O Lord, by your perpetual mercy. And because without you the frailty of our nature causes us to fall, keep us from all things hurtful, and lead us to all things profitable for our salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of God's Word.
Today's lesson is from Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, keep justice and do righteousness, for soon my salvation will come and my righteousness will be revealed. Blessed is the man who does this, and the son of the man who holds it fast, who keeps the Sabbath, not profaning it, and keeps his hand from doing any evil. Let not the foreigner who has joined himself to the Lord say, the Lord will surely separate me from his people. And let not the eunuch say, behold, I am a dry tree. For thus says the Lord, to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths, who choose the things that please me, and hold fast my covenant, I will give in my house and within my walls a monument and a name better than sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. And the foreigner who joined themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be his servants. Everyone who keeps the Sabbath and does not profane it, and holds fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all people. The Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel, declares, I will gather yet others to him besides those already gathered. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. May God be merciful to us and bless us. Show us the light of his countenance and come to us. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. May God give us his blessing, and may all the ends of the earth stand in awe of him.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Please stand for the reading of the Gospel. This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
And Jesus went away from there and withdrew to the district of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and was crying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely oppressed by a demon." But he did not answer her a word. And his disciples came and begged him, saying, "Send her away, for she is crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered, "It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord. Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "O woman, great is your faith. Be it done for you as you desire." And her daughter was healed instantly. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Let us pray. Lord, as we open your word today, I pray that you would open our eyes, our ears, to hear from you what it is that you'd say to us from your word. And Lord, as we meditate on these words from your gospel that may seem harsh, that you would give us understanding of what it is that's going on in this story. And I pray, Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be pleasing to you, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. My name is Chris Myers. I'm one of the priests here. And today, we call Promotion Sunday, and it's Promotion Sunday in two senses. The first is that the kids level up grades. So, here's what I'm going to say to you parents. If you have school-age children, congratulations. You did it. You survived the summer. Many of you went back to school this week, and many of you are going back to school this week. And the second reason we call it Promotion Sunday is we highlight our teams and some of the ways that you can volunteer and get connected here at St. Bart's, so we'll be talking about that in a minute. My daughter actually asked me last night if today was Commotion Sunday, which I thought was an even better name for what we're doing here, so maybe next year we'll call it Commotion Sunday. So we have these scriptures before us. And as we get into them, I want you to think about this idea that sometimes surprising things cease to be surprising. So something that once that you experienced as shocking or surprising or out of the ordinary, over time becomes unsurprising to you, overly familiar. So this could be something maybe slightly trivial, like the twist ending of a movie. The ending of The Sixth Sense is no longer a surprise, and if it is to you, the statute of limitations is over. Or the fact that something like D-Day actually worked. That's pretty shocking, that the invasion of Normandy actually turned the tide of the war. We take it for granted looking back at it, but it's actually surprising that it worked. That can happen with the gospel, too. That can happen with our faith, is that there are things that are absolutely surprising and shocking about our faith that become overly familiar. The resurrection, I think, is the great reversal of all time. It's the great surprise of all time. That moving through death back into life, Jesus is raised from the dead and vindicated as the true King, the true Savior of the world. That's a great surprise. And in our passages today, we're reminded of an even greater surprise, or not a greater surprise, but a great surprise in its own right. And I can sum it up the way that Paul sums it up in Romans 15, verses 8 and 9. And this is what Paul says, "For I tell you that Christ became a servant of the circumcised to show God's truthfulness in order to confirm the promises given to the patriarchs and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy." Why is that surprising? Christ, that word means anointed one. The other word for it is Messiah. The surprise is this, is that Israel's Messiah is the Savior of all peoples. Not just the Jews, but the Gentiles too. And the reason that this is surprising to us is because we forget that we're Gentiles. We forget our Gentileness. It's invisible to us that we've been included in the covenant, that Christ came for us. And these two passages, the first from Isaiah and the second from the Gospels, give us these two powerful instances of people who you would expect to be excluded who suddenly become included. And that they come and become included within Israel's story, not despite Israel's story. So the prophet Isaiah gives us the jarring image of the eunuch in the temple. Again, maybe that's not a shocking image to you, but it would be to Isaiah's hearers. And the gospel passage from Matthew gives us the image of the Canaanite woman. And this story can't help but shock because Jesus calls her a dog. And what do we do with that? So let it shock you, let it surprise you, so we can sit with it and remember that God has included us in his promises and in his story of salvation. So in Isaiah 56, we have this prophecy, and you can turn to it. It's on page 3 of your bulletin. "Thus says the Lord, keep justice and do righteousness, for soon my salvation will come and my righteousness be revealed." This all sounds very, you know, straightforward, prophetic kind of poetry. But then in verse 3, it says, "Let not the foreigner who has joined himself to the Lord say, the Lord will surely separate me from his people." Well, our expectation would actually be that the foreigner would be separated from his people, that there was a sharp division between God's promised people and those who were outside of that. And yet, the story of the Old Testament gives us these surprising reversals of that. Rahab, Ruth, Uriah the Hittite, Naaman the Syrian, and here, a very unexpected person include the eunuch. Now, I'm not going to talk a lot about eunuchs. If you're interested, The Rest Is History has a podcast episode called History's Top 10 Eunuchs. So you can go listen to that if you want to know more about eunuchs. But the point here is that a eunuch would not have the expectation of being fruitful and having children. And what does God say? What does the Lord say to the eunuch? "To the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths, who choose the things that please me and hold fast my covenant, I will give in my house and within my walls a monument and a name better than sons and daughters." That is unexpected. That is a surprise. First and foremost, because based on the law itself, the eunuch should not be part of the ritual worship of Israel. And even more so because of this promise of something better than sons and daughters. That to be part of the covenant people of God is to have an everlasting name. To be joined to the people of Abraham is to participate in the blessing that God promised to Abraham, that I will make your descendants outnumber the stars, and that through your seed, your offspring, all the nations of the world will be blessed. That's the gospel. That we are blessed, that we Gentiles are blessed because God made a covenant with Abraham. That God chose this one man and that through that blessed the whole world because Jesus was in that line. And he's the blessing to all nations. The end of this prophecy of Isaiah probably may have rung a little bell in your mind, Because in verse 7, it says, "These I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar." And this is the part that might be familiar to you. "For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples." That's what Jesus says when he cleanses the temple. My house, the temple, will be a house not just for Jews, but for all peoples, all the Gentiles, all the nations. When Jesus cleanses the temple, the part of the temple that he cleanses is called the court of the Gentiles. So one way to think of what Jesus is doing is it's not just that the money changing is corrupt, though it is. It's that they are taking up space that does not belong to them. They are taking up space that belongs to the nations. That God, his intention was to gather the nations to him in his presence at the temple. That's a surprise. And yet Jesus reminds us of it by saying, "For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples." So we have the surprise of the eunuch. As one translator puts a verse from this passage, "Let not the eunuch say, 'Why, I am a withered tree.'" God says, "No, you're not. You're a fruitful tree." How? "By being part of my covenant people by faith." Which brings us to Matthew 15 and the Canaanite woman. So you can flip over to that on page 5. Here we have this contrast between Jew and Gentile raised to its highest fevered pitch. It's not just a Jew and a Gentile, it's a Jew and a Canaanite. Matthew is careful to call her a Canaanite, whereas in Mark, she is called a Syrophoenician woman. Matthew says she's a Canaanite. Who are the Canaanites? Well, they were the ones who occupied the land and were driven out because of their false worship, because of their corrupt pagan practices, and they were driven out by someone named Joshua. Jesus is Joshua's namesake, and here a Canaanite stands in front of the new Joshua and asks for mercy. This is surprising, because Joshuas and Canaanites don't usually get along. And what does she say to him? This is surprising too. "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David." Who's the Son of David? The Messiah, the Christ, the Anointed One, promised to who? Israel? But she is begging for mercy from him as a Canaanite. So I want you to hear this. She's not crying out to a generic holy man or the shaman of the week. She's crying out to the Lord, the Son of David. She has an insight. And this is an absolutely astonishing thing for a Canaanite to say. And Jesus' initial response is shocking, because his initial response is no response at all. He just keeps walking. And she keeps crying. And the disciples say, "Will you just please send her away?" Because when it says she cried out, this was not a one-time cry out. She was continuing to cry out, begging for mercy for her child, begging for mercy from the Son of David. So it moves from silence to rebuke, and then he delivers the coup de grace. "It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." Ouch. What do we do with this? Now, there's all sorts of ways that people have tried to explain this away, and I don't know if I have a good explanation, other than we know Jesus' character, we know his intention is mercy. Some people want to say that Jesus was just grumpy that day. He had a long day of ministry and he was tired. I don't think that that befits the Son of God to say that. But one way to think about it is that the passage itself is set up for these two characters to play the stereotypical role of a Jew and the bad Gentile, Canaanite. And that there's a sense in which they fall into their roles. And almost in a sense, based on her response, it's like she knows that Jesus is kind of winking at her. I don't know if that's exactly right, but maybe it is. Because her retort is something like someone who knows that she's in on the joke. because for her, a crumb is enough. She embraces the description of herself as a dog. But what happens in the Greek of the story is that she calls herself a little dog. This is not a dog that's outside the house. This is a dog that's in the house. And not just in the house, but under the table. So what does she acknowledge but that the Lord is the Lord, and that the Lord is the Lord of the table? And in acknowledging that, she acknowledges that the crumbs from that table are sweeter, fairer than the greatest feast at any other table. In a way, she's echoing what the psalmist said when he said, "I would gladly be a doorman in the house of the Lord than dwell in the tents of the wicked." It says something about the greatness of the Lord. Does it take the sting out of the passage? Probably not. I think we're meant to sort of uncomfortably sit with what Jesus is saying here. But we have to acknowledge the beauty and the depth of her faith. And what this surprising story helps remind us is that we are God's people, and that's unexpected. We are basically Canaanites. We're the dogs too, and yet we have been included. So what does it mean for us to call ourselves the people of God? Again, most of us are, to use the language of the New Testament, Gentiles. I don't think any of us go around self-describing ourselves as Gentiles. Hi, I'm a Gentile. But we are. We are those who were not part of the covenant, but who have been included into the covenant. And the reason that this is so is because the gospel has gone forth out into the world and is even now going to the ends of the nations. The nations, Gentiles, us. That the promises of Israel become promises to us because of Jesus. So maybe these stories, the eunuch in the temple and the Canaanite woman, can remind us of the astonishing fact that God has included us in his promises by means of Israel's Messiah. That's exactly what Paul was saying at the very beginning. Romans 15, 8 and 9. I tell you that Christ became a servant to the circumcised, the Jews, to show God's truthfulness in order to confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. And again, we must remember that the Canaanite woman calls Jesus the son of David. She recognizes, maybe just in seed form, that Israel's Messiah, the Christ, the son of David, that God promised to David that one of his descendants would rule on a throne forever, is actually the Savior of the world and has something to bless Canaanites and Gentiles too. And it's surprising that the way that he brings his blessing to us is by fulfilling Israel's covenant. This is another surprise, that the particular leads to the universal. What do I mean by that? One man, Abraham, one promise to him, becomes the blessing to all nations through Jesus, his son. And what that makes us, or what we're called into as a response to that, is to be a people of humility. Because we don't deserve a place at the table. We don't. In his mercy, he includes us, but we don't deserve a place at the table. And the more that we think we deserve our seat at the table, the more we will ignore those who are not yet at the table, or worse, actively seek to exclude them, because we think we earned our place, but we didn't. So we need to invite those. They don't deserve it either, we didn't either, but there's mercy to spare. The Catholic bishop, Robert Barron, was talking about this passage, and he used this image of walls and bridges. And I'm just going to straight up steal this from him because it was so helpful for me. He says that to be the church means we have to have both walls and bridges. What are the walls? Well, the walls are what God has said, the covenant itself, what God has revealed in his words, what we would say is codified in the creeds, the truth of what it means to be part of the people of God. That there is a distinction. That we believe things that other people don't believe. That we acknowledge things like the two natures of Christ and the Trinity that define who we are as a people, and we need those walls. But we also need bridges so that people can come in. We need ways to reach out, to go out, so that there's a way in to the structure. And this is what he said that was so helpful and challenging to me. And I want you to think about this. If the church is nothing but walls, then no one can get in or out. And the point becomes about preserving the walls. And he said that that is the temptation of the conservative. To be nothing but wall builders and wall protectors and wall defenders. But then there's no way in. But similarly, if the church is nothing but bridges, where are you leading people? If there's no structure, if there's no distinction, that this is what we believe, this is who we are, this is what we do, this is what we don't do, then in the end, then there's nothing extraordinary about the gospel. It's kind of a bridge to nowhere. I'm okay and you're okay is not good news. It's not. We should be out on the lake on a paddle boat if I'm okay and you're okay. We don't need to be here. We don't need to be reminding ourselves that we don't deserve our place at the table, and yet we have been included. And what Robert Barron said is that to build nothing but bridges is the temptation of the liberal. So there's a temptation of the conservative to build nothing but walls, and there's a temptation of the liberal to build nothing but bridges, and guess what? We need both. We need the structure, and we need the bridges. We need the way in, but we also need to define what we're inviting people into. We need both. So we have clarity about who we are and what we believe, but then we have a posture of compassion towards those people who don't yet share those beliefs. Creating a hospitable environment where people can ask questions about it, try those things on, figure out what it means to believe those things, what it means to behave in the way that God has asked us to behave. To invite others to the table. The story of the Canaanite woman is preserved in the Anglican tradition in a very particular way. One of the most famous prayers of the Book of Common Prayer is called the Prayer of Humble Access. And we say this prayer during the season of Lent. How does the prayer go? We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. And here's the line. We are not so much worthy as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. That's it precisely. We don't deserve our place at the table. A crumb would be enough. And why is it that a crumb is enough? The story immediately after the Canaanite woman's story is the feeding of the 4,000. Where God can take a piece of bread and feed a multitude. And that is the promise of this table, is that God feeds us with himself and that he promises to meet us here. There's a sense in which the Canaanite woman points us to this table, to our response as we come forward. And I say this all the time. Our posture in communion is this. We do not take it, we receive it. Because we can't feed ourselves. That's why we pray the Lord's Prayer as part of our communion. Give us this day our daily bread. That's a beggar's prayer. I can't feed myself. I cannot give to myself what I actually need. But who are you, Lord? You are the one whose character is always to have mercy. So that I can find my place at the table. That's why this table enacts what it is to be the church. Because we are fed here, nourished here as the body of Christ, with the body of Christ, to then go into the world to be the body of Christ so that there could be a bridge in. We need that nourishment. We need that reminder. We need that encounter with him. And we need that posture of humility. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for these stories. I thank you for stories that shock us, that make us wrestle with the meaning of your gospel, your character as a merciful Lord. And I pray, Lord, that the surprise of the gospel would be a surprise for us again, that you've included us, Gentiles, that you've invited us to your table, and that you've given us the mission to invite others to that table. Help us to be that people as St. Bart's. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand. And let us say together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please kneel for the prayers of the people. Let us pray to God, the bountiful giver, for the needs of the church and all people. We give thanks for the grace that always exceeds what we can hope or ask. As we are fed by word and sacrament, make us strong in your service. Lord, we pray that your church would be a place, and that this church would be a place where we have both clarity and compassion, and that we invite those who are not yet part of your people to feast at your table. Lord, in your mercy, feed the spiritual hunger of the world where many are lost in desert places, far from their true home. We pray for the nations, Lord, places of conflict, of turmoil, for the Ukraine, for Yemen, for Sudan, for Maui. We pray that those who only know you partially would know you fully, and that you would bring them into the perfect light of your love. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, as your people, we pray that you would show us the way to relieve the needs that lie close to us. Help us to see East Dallas as you see it, and to be a blessing to it. We ask that you would take our small offerings and make them great in your service. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, we pray that the compassion of Christ would still prevail to heal the sick and feed the hungry through the divine love that never fails. And we lift to you, Lord, those names of people in need of healing. Lord, in your mercy, grant refreshment, light, and peace to those who no longer need the bread of this world. Receive them into their eternal home. And strengthened by our spiritual food, we pray with confidence in the generous love of Christ that you would answer, Lord, these prayers in your time, in your way, in your will, to the glory of your name. Amen. Please stand. May the peace of the Lord be always with you. Please share the peace. As the kiddos come in, please be seated. Welcome to Commotion Sunday. We're so glad that you're with us today at St. Bart's. As I said, my name is Chris Myers. I'm one of the priests here. Our rector, Dave Larley, has been on sabbatical, and he will be back next Sunday. He and his family have arrived back safely in Dallas, and he'll be slowly onboarding back in over the week. So continue to pray for him. And then next Sunday, we'll have a few things going on. The first is baptisms. So if you or somebody you love wants to be baptized, just let us know, and we will take care of that. And then we will also have kind of a welcome back time for Dave and Rachel and the boys. So there will be food in the parking lot and cooler fans and some ways to kind of make it pleasant. And hopefully it'll be nice and cool relatively. So we'll welcome them back. We'll have food together. It'll kind of be another way to launch the fall and kick things off. So make plans to be here August 27th. We also have an annual parish meeting in the evening on August 31st. We'll be here from 7 to 9. It'll be a time of prayer, worship, and we'll look over the financials from the previous year. We'll have some time to cast vision for where we're going over the course of this year, and that will be kind of a time for Dave to share what he learned and what his sabbatical, what resonated with him, what he's bringing back to us from that time. So make plans to be with us for the annual parish meeting. Just a reminder, two other things. If this is your first time at St. Bart's, we're so glad that you're here. We would love to connect with you. There's a connection card in the back of the bulletin that you can tear off, fill out, and put in the offering plate as it goes by. If you want to get together with me or someone from the staff, we'd love to get coffee with you, tell you more about who we are and what we do, why we do it, that sort of thing. Or if you have a prayer request, anything like that, you can put it on the connection card. And just as a reminder, as you come forward to communion and go back to your seats, there are prayer teams in the back, and they're ready, willing, and able to pray with you about anything that's going on in your life. The other layer of Promotion Sunday, in addition to the kids leveling up to grades, is promoting our teams and our volunteer needs. It takes 30 to 40 volunteers on any given Sunday just to pull off what we do in the service. And that's not even counting what we need in the children's ministry. So I'm going to talk to Julia Fisher. She's going to tell us a little bit about serving and that kind of thing. So welcome, Julia. Hi, Julia. How are you?
Hi, good.
This is Julia. Tell us a little bit about yourself, your family, how long you guys have been here. And
I'm Julia Fisher. My family and I moved here about 4 years ago, a little over 4 years ago, and pretty quickly found St. Bart's and knew it would be our church home. I still remember I was very postpartum with my second child at the time, and driving home and looking at my husband, and my mom happened to be in town. They're also here, my parents are here, and my sister too. And we just agreed that St. Bart's would be our new church home, and so it's been such an honor to be here and invest.
Great. And you've served different capacities. Matt serves on different teams.
Yep.
Where and how have you served here, because there's all kinds of teams and ways
yes.
to serve. So,
yes, there are a lot of teams. Like you just said, it takes a bunch of people to make this beautiful, important service happen every Sunday. And I've been serving on the children's ministry about once a month. And then I also host a regular small group with our connection group with my husband, Matt, at our home. And then I've just been brought on to the vestry.
That's right. Yes.
It's an honor.
We have a vestry meeting today. Please
be
at that. So what led you to want to serve on a team or at church in general?
Yeah. I feel that it's very important for myself to serve all of you, as I also receive that from all of you. And so right away I knew I wanted to get involved in the children's ministry specifically because our three kids have so benefited and been nourished by the amazing program that Katie Christina, Cassie have all been a part of. I feel like our congregation's half children now,
yes,
or something.
At least.
At least. Yeah. So I know they need our support, and also they just do it so intentionally. So I knew that was something I wanted to be a part of, to learn from, to contribute to. And the connection group has been such a gift to follow along with people on a regular basis during the week, to be praying for one another, to enhance personal connections within the church.
Yeah. So how has serving on a team affected your experience just being part of this community? Does it change kind of the way you experience being in worship or not? It doesn't have to.
I'm like, it doesn't at all. So, no, it
makes no difference.
It has genuinely deepened the connection I have with this church in many different ways. One of them is to get to minister to many of your children. I teach the twos and threes, and it has deepened my connection to them, to many of you, some of you whom I know really well, some whom I'm getting to know. But just to get to know your children and to see the beauty of their wonder for Christ and to, you know, witness that childlike faith that we are all urged to have has really deepened my connection to the church, to God. And it has encouraged me to continue to serve because, I mean, Christ is a servant, and I feel personally called to be pursuing that in my life, whether convenient or even inconvenient.
Sure.
Although St. Bart's makes it really easy to serve.
Yeah.
You really do. They do a great job of honoring your boundaries and capacity and allowing you to work within your gifts.
Absolutely. So last question, what would you say to someone who's wondering about whether or not they should be on a team?
Would say you should do it. We need you and your gifts. And like I just said too, your capacity, what you can offer, what you can't offer, what you don't want to do, all of that can be taken into consideration. Everyone here is busy and you have the incredibly valuable resource of time, and we know that's limited. So know that there is a way for you to serve where you can do it with what you have. For me personally, Katie has done a beautiful job where with the twos and threes class, I can show up at 9 a.m. sharp and prep for the lesson and be teaching by 9:15. It's always important to keep those children and that lesson in my prayers, but it doesn't require a lot of prep time. If you don't want to come here early, you don't have to. If you can't stay here late, you don't have to. There are so many teams and so many opportunities to give. And so you can figure out what works for you. And just know, too, that also sacrifice is okay.
Sure.
And I've had to tell myself that. And it's important to do that. So I would encourage anyone wondering to just take the step, see how it goes. Also, you get a chance to get to know a lot of the congregation, so many of these wonderful people that are behind the scenes, and that is really enriching too.
Great. Thank you so much. Give a hand to Julia. In your bulletin, there's a card, and it describes the different teams that we have. So you can see the information about what a team is and what it involves. And if you were like, hey, I'm ready to sign up, you can check that and put it in the offering plate. Next week, we will also, as part of the kickoff and the feasting together, team leaders will be available. So if you want to learn, hey, what is chalice bearing, what does it involve, or what does it mean to be on the scripture team, or any of the different teams, you'll have a chance to speak with those leaders as well. Thank you, Julia. As we come to our time of Holy Communion, if you are baptized and following our Lord Jesus, you are welcome to receive. As you come forward, place your hands like this, and we will dip the wafer for you in the wine. Place it in your hands. If you need a gluten-free wafer for some reason, place your hands like this. If you don't want to receive communion for any reason at all, please come forward, place your hands like this, and we will pray a prayer blessing over you. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice unto God. Thank you. We offer this Holy Communion to the glory of God and in celebration of Sandy and Paul Stoller's 62 years of marriage. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son.
You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you.
In Christ, you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us.
He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin.
On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life.
At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord.
With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you the sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Please sit or kneel as we sing together the words Christ our Savior has taught us. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Friends, these are the gifts of God, and they are given for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you.
is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. Sing that again, your name. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all power, thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear your people sing, holy, to the King.
Your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. Sing it again, your name. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, King of Kings, holy, you will always be, holy, holy forever. Sing that one more time. Hear your people sing, holy, hear your people sing, holy, to the King of.
Lord God, we thank you for the foretaste that you give us in this feast at the table, of the feast that you will take us to when we will cry with all creation, all angels and all saints, that you are holy, 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 Lord. Thank you for a taste of that. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. Before we do birthday prayers, we're going to do a prayer for students and teachers just as the school year is launching. So if you are a student going back to school, please stand. If you are a teacher, an administrator, if you're involved with education at any level, please stand. We'd love to pray for you. And those around you, just extend a hand of blessing to those who are standing. O eternal God, bless all preschools, elementary schools, middle schools, and high schools, that they may be lively centers for sound learning, new discovery, and the pursuit of wisdom. And grant that those who teach and those who learn may find you to be the source of all truth through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. For colleges and seminaries, too. I'm going to add that in. Do you have anybody who has a birthday this week? Please come forward. We'll love to pray for you. Everybody cashed in their birthday chip last week. How old are you going to be? 10. Awesome. All right, let's pray for these birthday girls. Watch over thy children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts, may thy peace, which passes all understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Happy birthday. Let's stand together and we'll pray our prayer for mission. Let us pray. Father, help us to live this day to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help us to give ourselves away to others, being kind to everyone we meet. Spirit, help us to love the lost. Claim Christ in all we do and say, amen. Now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you always. Amen. Remain standing for our closing hymn. Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.